And Lantarton, this is the world famous Aintree race course, home of the greatest steeplechase in the world. It is, of course, home of the Grand National.
At over 4 miles long, with 30 challenging fences to jump, the Grand National Steeplechase is a test of pure endurance for both the horse and its jockey. Yet, what makes this such an attractive and amazing race? Well, historian Jane Clark, in an interview with the Liverpool Echo, compared it to the FA Cup final. A day where emotions are high, your spine tingles and your hair stands on end. Being from Liverpool myself, I cannot deny how true this is. It is, as champion jockey AP McCoy puts it, the race the world stops to watch. The Grand National has seen some amazing horses cross the finish lines, both favourites and outsiders. From Lottery, the first winner in 1839, to One Foot Arthur, the winner of this year's illustrious race. The history of the Grand National is rich with success stories.
It was the idea of William Lynn, a local Liverpool hotelier, who leased the land in Aintree from William Molyneux, 2nd Earl of Sefton at the time. Lynn set out a course and built a grandstand, to which Lord Sefton laid the foundation stone for on the 7th of February 1829. It is believed that the first ever run in the Grand National took place on the 26th of February 1839, in conditions that were immensely different than today. Starting near the Mellon Road, the first steeplechase took place over ploughed land, with the horse jumping over natural banks and plain fences and a few stone walls. It seems only coincidental that the winner that day was a horse named Lottery, as that is what the race has gone on to be seen as, particularly by the betting shops. However, the race is not without historiographical debate, with historian John Pinfold claiming that there have been races here since 1836, 3 years before it was indeed recorded. This is often disregarded, though, and many believe that they have not actually run over this course, but rather down at the Gull, a few miles. However, recent discoveries by historians have seen Pinfold's argument supported, with the claim being that the first three races were not deemed as being nationals.
While it was the idea of Mr. Lynn, had it not been for Mr. Edward William Topham and his family, the race would not be what we know it as today. He was responsible for turning the Grand National into a handicap, and in 1843, after it had been a wafer age race for the first 4 years. The Topham family had owned substantial lands around this course, and in 1949 they bought it outright from Lord Sefton, who had leased the land since the racecourse's opening in 1829.
Foynavon sensationally won the 1967 Grand National in bizarre circumstances, when, at fence 23, the smallest in the circuit, the riderless Popham's arm cuts across the course, causing a major pile-up that almost halted the race. Coming from the rear, the jockey of Foynavon saw what was unfolding and took action to avoid it. Here is the original broadcast and spectacular commentary by Michael O'Hare.
The leader is Castle Falls, with Rutherford's along the inside, and Rutherford has been hampered, and so has Castle Falls. Rochetta has fallen, Principal has fallen, Norther has fallen, Curtain Lad has fallen, the Fossa has fallen. There's a right pile up. Leedsy has climbed over the fence and left his jockey there, and now with all this mayhem, Foynavon has gone off on his own. He's about 50, 100 yards in front of everything else.
Foynavon, the unconsidered outside of him, John Buckingham holding Josh Gifford on Honeyearn. Then comes Greek Scullin and Red Alligator. They're racing up towards the line now, and it's Foynavon who missed that melee at Beaches, going well clear to a fantastic Grand National triumph. Honeyearn is second, Red Alligator's coming up to be third, and at the line, John Buckingham looks over his shoulder, sees there's no danger, ears pricked. Foynavon wins the National.
The commentary by O'Hare of the carnage that day ranks amongst the greatest moments in televised sport, and is often shown during nostalgic sporting montages. O'Hare received a lot of respect from his colleagues for the speed in which he identified Foynavon in the pile-up. Here is an interview on The Late Show in 1975, talking about the events of that day.
It was a little bit of luck too, because I have a habit before the National, being in the weigh room, looking at all the jockeys weighing out.
Yes.
And I have memorized colors for the 6 weeks before that, and I kind of checked them off in my mind. And I saw this fellow with a black jacket and a yellow and red braces on him. So he's not on my list. And I went up and said, "Johnny, what's that?" He said, "Oh, this is Foynavon," he said. But I said to him, "At Cheltenham, that wore light green and dark green quartered." "Oh yes," he says, the owner thought the green was unlucky, and he's going to try it with these colors today." Now, if I hadn't been in the spot at the time and saw him, I'd be wondering, what the hell's that thing in black coming over 100 yards behind everything
that
else?
One horse, because what astonished me about that is how
quickly
they
come to the last fence in the National, and Red Brown with a tremendous chance of winning his third National. He jumps it clear of Churchtown Boy. He's getting the most tremendous cheer from the crowd. They're winning him home now. The 12-year-old Red Brown being preceded only by loose horses, being chased by Churchtown Boy. I catch him as moved into third of the Phil Garlick fourth. They're coming to the elbow. There's a fair long now between Red Brown and his third Grand National triumph, and he's coming up to the line to win it like a fresh horse in great style. His hat's off and a tremendous reception. You've never heard one like it at Liverpool. Red Brown wins the National.
Red Brown was, and is to this day, the only horse to ever win three Grand Nationals, with an outside victory in 1973 when he pipped Australian racehorse Chris to the finishing line after being 15 lengths behind. He came back again in 1974 and became one of four horses to accomplish a back-to-back victory. Having finished second the next 2 years, he broke history again when he crossed the finish line for first in 1977 for the third and final time. Red Brum's trainer went on to train four of the winners of the Grand National, three being Red Brum and the fourth being Amberley Knobs, who won the 2004 meeting. Being only the second trainer to accomplish this feat, he has managed to make it onto the Grand National Legends Wall, where him and his horse Red Rum are both situated. After his retirement in 2006, McCain's son Donald took over control of the stable and trained the winner of the 2011 race, BIBLIOGRAPHY. Not like keeping it in the family, is there?
One of the most hardest and most challenging fences out of the 16 on the course is Beecher's Brook, famously named after the greatest jockey of the 19th century, one Captain Beecher. After famously falling at what now is the sixth fence, he lives on as a legend. After returning from the Napoleonic Wars, Beecher, an experienced horse rider, took to racing, winning many famous races during his life, yet he will only be remembered for falling at the Brook. A fence that, as this picture shows, is a 4'10" jump with an almost 7-foot drop on the other side. Deemed the second hardest fence on the course behind the chair, it has claimed many fallers and horses over the years, causing the British Horse Racing Authority, or the BHA, to impose strict new guidelines which came into effect in 2013 to make the fence safe. Following the conclusion of the race in 1839, Beecher famously expressed how dreadful water is without the benefit of whiskey, something we can all attest to. 1920 saw the introduction of radio to the race, when in 1927, the British Broadcasting Corporation brought the race to its biggest ever audience to date, when Sprig was the victor. With a total broadcast time of just over an hour, the Radio Times described it as an experiment to forestall potential criticism. On that day, it was journalist Meyrick Good who provided the commentary, with King George V by his side. As the race drew to an end, his voice was drowned out by those in attendance, with, he claims, an estimated 10 million people tuning in at home.
1960 saw the Grand National hit television when the BBC broadcast the race for the live for the first time. The 114th meeting saw Merriman II win it, becoming not only the first horse to be televised winner of the National, but also the first favourite to win it in 33 years. In the words of co-presenter David Coleman, those who witnessed it saw history unfold in front of them. That day, the BBC had deployed 16 cameras around the course, with Peter Sullivan being the man behind the microphone that day. Since then, the BBC have gone on to broadcast the race 51 times, only losing the rights in 2013 to Channel 4. And again, in 2010, Aintree made history when that year's race was the first horse race to be televised in HD in the UK. From Charlotte Brew, the first female jockey in 1977, there have been many who have taken to horseback on the Grand National. To date, there have been 19 meetings in which a female jockey has participated, with only Katie Walsh, sister of two-time winner Ruby Walsh, placing the highest in 2013 when she took Seabass to third. However, Katie was not the first woman to have completed this course, with Geraldine Reese achieving the feat in 1982 when she finished last. In 2005, there was a huge media presence surrounding Carrie Ford when she took to the field just 10 weeks after giving birth to her daughter.
Well, hi, bonus facts! alongside the famous horse race course, is a car racing track, which was first used in 1954, and is measured at just over 3 miles long. It has hosted 5 British Grand Prix and holds the title of being host to the second closest finish in Formula One history. The course went on to host further Grand Prix until it was sold and the British Grand Prix moved to Silverstone, with the track still being used today for club racing events. The chair is the tallest fence on the course at 5'2" and the broadest. The fence got its name as it was once alongside the seat used by the distance judge. Don't Push It, trained by John Joe O'Neill and owned by legendary gambler JP McManus, provided perennial champion jockey Tony McCoy with his first Grand National win at the 15th attempt. McCoy went on to win the BBC Sports Personality of the Year award that year, the first person from horse racing to do so.